We have Steve Caldwell here of the Orlons. Now, those were the first two. Where did you, get these two songs that started out the career of the Orlons? Where did they come from? From the company or from...
Yeah, from the company. Cowman, Dave Apple were the writers for Cameo Parkway at that time.
Right, Dave Apple of Dave Apple and the Applejacks.
Yeah, Dave Apple and the Applejacks. That's correct. you definitely did your homework.
I remember seeing Dave Apple and the Applejacks on the Freed shows at the Brooklyn Paramount.
Yes, yes, a very funny guy. He was a...
And interestingly enough, at that point in time, as a youngster going to see these shows, I wasn't sure who Dave Apple was. You know what I mean? I didn't know, he's all right. Yeah, but, I didn't know that he was behind the scenes doing a lot of...
Yes.
He wrote some of the material.
He wrote a lot of the material. He arranged a lot of them. He played guitar on a lot of them. He was just proficient in the studio with us. You know, we gave him, I guess you could say, something to work with. And he went all out working with us, you know.
Right. Now, you mentioned that, Len Barry had something to do with hooking you up. So where did that connection come in? I know you're all from the Philadelphia area, but how did he either come upon you or you knew him and he connected you with Call Man, who in turn hooked you up with a record deal, I guess?
Right. What happened there was with the girls in Overbrook High School where Lenny... And the guys in the Dovells were the Cashmeres at that time.
That was their name prior to being the Dovells,
prior to being the Dovells.
In fact, isn't that one of the reasons that you guys became the Orlons?
That's why
the Cashmere
we became
Orlons,
the Orlons. Yes. It was,
another group would have been the Cottons or something.
It was definitely a search for a name, you know, that would befit another Philadelphia group.
Right.
That was about to do some recording. But like I said, Lenny... And the girls went in Overbrook High School together, and after Lenny did their audition and recorded the Bristol Stomp, he gave up the name of the girls.
Mm-hmm.
And what they did was they called us, and we went and auditioned. Again, it was a fact made that they were looking for a female act. I was fortunate at that time that the girls would not go without me. So I don't know how long that lasted, but you know.
But did somebody say, when you walked in, you know, you had three ladies and yourself, did somebody say, who's this guy? Let's get rid of him and put another girl in the group?
This had gone around for a while, you know, but like I said, in the beginning, after the five girls broke up, and I became the lead singer in front of Shirley, Marlene, and Rose. They got comfortable, and they were comfortable in what they were doing, singing behind me. When we went to the company, they auditioned us with me singing the lead.
Mm-hmm.
So the other things that happened in a 6-month period of time with them trying each one of the girls in the lead position and putting me in the background.
And they wound up with Rosetta, I guess. Was the voice that they...
Yeah, again, picked. The commercial, being the, they were really commercial orientated as far as looking for a certain sound.
Hmm.
We did tons of audition taped recordings, and they were just looking for a certain thing, you know, and that's, they found it in Rose.
Right. Now, the first two songs you did, I'll Be True and Happy Birthday, Mr. 21, were okay. I mean, they weren't monster hits or anything.
No.
But even before you had, as you mentioned, the Wah-Wah Tusi, you were singing on hit records, weren't you? I mean,
yes.
Backing up a lady by the name of D.D. Sharp?
D.D. Sharp.
Yeah, and a couple of hit tunes like Mashed Potatoes,
Gravy,
How did they recruit you for that? Because it was the same company? Is that what it was?
Because it was the same company, and I'll give you something. I tried to talk my girls out of doing the Mashed Potatoes thing behind Dee Dee because I felt that it wasn't for us, the Orlons, you know, and it turned out that it wasn't for us. The girls made $20 a piece, and Dee Dee made the millions, you know. This is something I felt.
And you got no label credit.
And got no credit at all. We only time the girls get credit is when someone like you, you know, knows it and speaks about it. We've had disc jockeys that more today are doing that. But during the time that record was Mashed Potatoes and Gravy was really, you know, up there, nobody mentioned that it was the
Orleans behind.
New Orleans doing the background.
Yeah. Were you on those records, too?
I did most of the stuff with the Dovells.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay, so you were backing up the Dovells.
Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting. All right, we're here in the doo-wop shop. Steve Caldwell of the Orleans, and you did mention the first big, big smash, the Wawa Tusi. Who wrote that? Was it Dave Apple?
That was Dave Apple and Cowman.
Okay, let's give a listen, and for anybody who doesn't remember, I doubt there are very few of those. CBS FM, that's the Wawa Tusi, the Orleans, and we have Steve Caldwell of the Orleans right here with us. Was it because of the success of the, you know, mashed potato and doing the gravy and all this kind of stuff that they decided to point the Orleans in that dance direction? And were you happy as a group, and were you personally happy?
Cowman was the type of writer that if he heard something that, again, that he felt would sound commercial, that's the way he went. And the dance craze was there, and Cal would sit down and he must have written 5 or 6 dance tunes in a couple of hours, you know, and then decided which act that he would give it to that was at the company, you know, because if you know Bristol Stomp, mm-hmm. Mashed potatoes, Wawa Tusi, you know, here we are, Cameo Parkway, doing all the dances, you know, keeping people on the floor, you know.
Right.
The commercial part of, you know, the getting the record sales is people enjoying the music and being able to dance to it, which brings in, you know, bandstand and what do you think about this tune, this dance, you know? And
sure.
The craze was the dances then, you know, so...
I guess you were happy with it, I would assume.
Oh, yeah,
right?
Being...
I mean, you want a hit record and you had one, so being, I mean, how could you not be, I suppose?
We were guided in a sense that this is best for you, you know? So we really didn't go whether we cared for it or not. We enjoyed the singing part of it, the execution of being in the, you know, executing them in the studios and... dealing with the musicians that were our musicians, with studio musicians, but they were like a family there, you know. So we went in the studio and did our job, you know, and recorded good songs.
Exactly, and had a great hit with that.